Hi, everybody. This is State Representative Leanne Krueger. Thanks so much for joining us here tonight for this virtual info session about spotted lanternfly. You know, spotted lanternfly was not something we were talking about a lot before the past year or so, but we've gotten calls and emails in our district office with folks who are seeing them for the first time in their
gardens and on their plants,
and they want to know what to do about them. So I'm pleased to have Sam Burnett with us here tonight. He's a master gardener with Penn State. He's been educating folks across the Commonwealth about spotted lanternfly and what to do about it. He's also one of the leading master gardeners on this topic. So if you're like me, you know, maybe last year you heard about spotted lanternflies and you saw them once or twice. But this summer, I've been seeing them all over the place. Like so many folks, I planted a home garden for the first time in a very long time, and I saw them showing up on my cucumber plants as those little spotted nymphs. I didn't actually know what they were at first, and I had to look them up. I'm also an avid runner, and I've realized these days as I'm out running, I'm seeing the adults all over the place, and I'm trying to keep my steps up and to squash as many as I can along my runs. So, Sam, thank you so much for joining us here tonight. Again, I know there's a lot of folks out there who really want to know what to do about this. How serious is it? What do we do now that we're seeing the adults? Is there anything we can do proactively to prevent them from coming next year? But thanks so much for joining us for this session today.
Happy to be joining you, Leanne. Let me see if I can get this presentation going here. Let me see. I think we're up and
And folks, while you're listening from home, if you've got questions that you want to be able to ask Sam tonight about spotted lanternfly, we're taking questions either through email or through phone. So you can email your question to repkruger@pahouse.net. That's repkruger at pahouse.net. Or you can give us a call and leave a message. We're checking those over the course of the webinar, and we'll be asking those questions live, too. The call number is 610-534-6880. 610-534-6880. So if you've got a question you want answered by a master gardener who knows more about this topic than almost anybody else in the region, go ahead and email us or call us with your question. Sam, take it away.
Great. So welcome to the evening's talk. I'm glad to have everybody here. As Leanne said, I'm a master gardener of Penn State. At our core, our content experts, our team of extension educators and the faculty at University Park and across all the 67 counties in Pennsylvania, and they leverage the work that's done at our research facilities across the state. And all of this work is done by professionals at these facilities who want to provide you with scientifically based information about horticulture. Just some housekeeping issues today. This session is going to be recorded. And as Leanne just said, if you have any questions, I'm going to hold the questions to the end because I have a lot of content to cover and I don't want to sort of get sidetracked on too many issues along the way. So, and I'll stick around and answer questions until they're all gone. So as long as people want to stick around and write in questions, I'm happy to answer them. So send your questions to Rep Krueger, as you see on the screen, repkruger@pahouse.net at any time. And we'll hold those and answer them all at the end of the presentation. And for your questions about your own plants and gardens, visit our Master Gardener website. And here's where the website is. Today's program is just one of the many services that our county master gardeners offer, so please don't hesitate to contact the one nearest to you with our gardening questions. Yours is, we're all in Delaware County. I hope you're in, you may or may not, I assume you're in Delaware County, but you go to, if you just type in PSU Master Gardener, you'll get to this website, and then you click on that circle site notation there on the left for county master gardener programs. It will take you to a list and you can pick up Delaware County or whatever county you're in and find us. And we do programs here, the kinds of things we do, answer garden questions. We speak before groups, which I'm doing right now. We write garden articles. We work with youth, all kinds of things around horticulture. It's a great program. There are over 3,000 master gardeners across the state, and to find out more about if you want to become a master gardener, We're offering our next class next summer. So go to the county website and sign up. So that's my plug for Master Gardeners. I also want to do a little acknowledgments for some people in the state who have been really sort of instrumental in providing all the content that's in this presentation. Beth Fenley is the Area Master Gardener Coordinator in Berks County, and she's really at the hub since they first landed here. Heather Leach is our research coordinator for the state, and she's probably more in tune with the research around the country and probably around the world than anyone else. And we meet with her bi-weekly to talk about what's going on with spotted lanternfly, and you'll see her name on any number of the slides through this presentation. And Emily Swackhammer, extension educator, she just is super doing lots of presentations and provided a lot of the material for this one. So let's get right into it. Spotted lanternfly was discovered in Pennsylvania in Berks County in 2014. Native to Asia, it came over, we think, in a pack of stones in 2012, based on the condition of the old and weathered egg masses. We think our version came from northern China, though we're not entirely sure. And one of the problems is the spotted lanternfly comes to us from China, and as such, in the United States, it has no known predators. It's not an invasive pest in China because there are natural predators that keep it under control. And so they haven't researched it much and actually don't have a lot of data on it. So for us, it's all new and we are learning every day more things about it. It was introduced into Korea in 2004, went through the country in about 2 or 3 years and pretty much decimated their wine industry, and it seems to be abating there, and we think we have some ideas to why that may be true, and I'll get to that in a little while. And then it went to Japan in 2009. It's in this country. It is in the blue state, in the blue areas that you see on the map. It's throughout southeastern Pennsylvania. It's now into New Jersey, and what I've most recently heard is it's pretty much all over New Jersey. Just recently, a colony has been seen in Long Island, a couple of colonies in western Maryland and in northern Virginia and eastern West Virginia, and in the areas just south of Pennsylvania, southeast Pennsylvania, in Delaware and Maryland. So that's where it is. It's in six states. It's been detected in four others, and it's moving. So we want to stop that. So why should we care? Well, it's a pest that has few predators. It's got a voracious appetite, and it breeds prolifically. I'm going to come back to that in a moment. The egg masses started hatching back in April, and the nymphs began appearing in your yard probably in early April or May. They've then gone through a number of stages, and by now you should be seeing adults. I live in Delaware County, in outside of Media, and while we saw few if any nymphs in the spring last year, they arrived last fall, and now we've seen nymphs all across the state. We're beginning to see all across the county. We're seeing them, the adults everywhere also. There's a potential for a significant economic impact. The most recent study had it at potentially $324 million annually in Pennsylvania. Very negative impact on tourism at parks and in our game lands. And it's more than just a nuisance to many homeowners. So, this notion of breeds prolifically, I just want to touch on that so you get a sense of the scale here. To give you some idea what that means is, if I want you to focus on the number 17. That's the reproductive rate of spotted lanternfly. If it was 1, the population would be constant. with each spotted lanternfly replicating itself once each year. If the rate was 2, it would double every year. If it was 3, it would triple, and so on. But to get my head around what does the rate 17 mean, I put together this little simple table which shows you what expansion might look like. We started out with single egg mass that arrived in 2012. 34 eggs survived. Last year, that would have meant over 816 million. And this year, the number would be in the billions. Of course, this assumes we've done nothing to control them, which we have. And so the numbers are maybe exaggerated, but the chart demonstrates the scope of the issue and how quickly it may get out of hand unless we do something, some landscape-wide approach to dealing with them. I mean, it is pretty ridiculous. So with that, let's move to talk about what does this all mean? Let's sort of put it in some context. Well, first off, it's not a health risk. The presence of spotted lanternfly does not put your health at risk. It doesn't bite. It's not been found to carry any pathogens. And while it may land on you for a short ride, it's much more interested in finding its next meal in a tree or a shrub or plant of any material than hanging around with you. It's not a property risk. It's not going to damage your building, your house, or your home. It's not, while they may come inside from time to time, it's not like the stink bug that got in and infested inside the house. They really don't want to do that. They want to be on trees. So it's really not, while they may land on your house and they may, you know, populate a particular area, they're not going to be there at any length, and they're really not going to do much damage to it because they can't feed on your house. They're a major nuisance pest from a homeowner's perspective. They can do damage to your, you know, they can decrease your property value because of the damage and the unsightliness of what they can do. But the thing you have to remember is that no matter what you or your neighbor do or don't do, if you have a heavy infestation in your area, they're going to be there. They are going to be there. And there's not much you can do to stop them from coming. You can do some things once they're there to mitigate the impact of them on your own home, but there's not much you can do to stop them from coming. And so you have to really sit back and not panic about all of this. With all of this volume coming at you, you have to just sit back and say, well, let's figure out what I can do to manage my situation and try to limit their spread and deal with them in my own environment. That's what we're going to talk about. So let's just go back to what is the spotted lanternfly? What's its life cycle? Well, you can begin anywhere on the circle. We'll begin with the eggs. They start out with an egg mass that's the eggs are laid in anywhere from probably somewhere in October through November until the freeze. And the egg masses look somewhat like the picture up on your upper right. We'll spend a little time on that. That's not the issue right now. It won't be the issue until November or through the winter. And then they hatch in May through later, April through May. And then they go through 3 stages, all of which look like the picture on your right-hand side of your screen. They're black with white dots. And they move around. They're quite, the first ones that come out are quite tiny, smaller than your little fingernail. You can probably tip 2 or 3 of them on your fingernail there. The third instar in June is more like the size of your fingernail. And then in late June into early July through September, you get the fourth instar. And I would say I'm not seeing many of the fourth instar around now. I saw a bunch through the summer, but they are red with black and white spots, quite attractive, and they move very, very quickly. And then in August through the next month or so, you have the adults that emerge, and they look like this with their wings spread open. They have that, they're very beautiful bugs, actually. come from a family of beautiful bugs. And that's what they look like when they're on the trees moving around, sort of a grayish, purplish gray with black spots. Again, quite an attractive bug. And they lay eggs in the fall in October through November and start the cycle all over again. We have one cycle a year. So it's from beginning to end. They go through that cycle every year. We don't have more than one cycle here, which is a good thing. And those are pictures of them up close and personal. First to third instar in the top two pictures. Fourth instar on the lower left, and then the adults. So they are very strong jumpers, and they jump away when approached or prodded. And actually, the early instars are really quite agile and jump around and are very difficult to catch individually or to eliminate. The banding that we do on trees, which we'll get to, is certainly one way of doing that, because trying to get them individually is very, very difficult. They feed on tender shoots due to their lack of strength of their muscular structure. And so they are on smaller plants, they're more apt to go on like roses, or they were on my young crepe myrtle for me this summer, or Representative Kruger was talking about them being on her cucumbers, and they were on my daughter's cucumbers. So they are on plants that are much more tender when they are young, which is not surprising. The spotted lanternfly is a hemipteran. It's not a moth or a butterfly, but a plant hopper. The spotted lanternfly belongs to the insect order Hemiptera, which is like cicadas, aphids, leafhoppers, and stink bugs. And what they all have in common is that they are all piercing, sucking mouth parts that allow them to feed on plant fats. So they insert their stylet into the plant and suck out their nutrients. So here you have an example of that. There's a hair-like stylet within this long beak. Display that. There it is, right there. That gets inserted into the plant's phloem. I think of it like a straw that they stick into the plant. And they don't have much musculature in their heads to be able to suck up nutrients. Sort of interesting how you've done a lot of research where they've dissected them to try and figure this out. But they can't suck so much, so they rely on the turgor pressure of the plant. And when you think of turgor pressure, I think the best example of that is think of maple sugar. Where does maple sugar come? Well, it comes from maple trees producing sap in the late winter. Well, and how does that happen? Well, that happens when the temperatures in the night range, I think it's below freezing at night and above 40 degrees during the day. And sustained warm weather in the daytime will cause this rapid release. And so all you have to do is tap the tree, you stick the plug into the tree, and the tree, because of the pressure in the tree, forces the sap from the fibers of the tree, and it comes out as the syrup for making maple sugar. Well, the same thing happens with these insects. They rely on the turgor of the plant. And one of the things we're learning is that they move from plant to plant. And we think one of the reasons they move is because of the varying turgor pressures within various plants at different times during the season. And also has to do with weather, of course, because plants don't generate much turgor when there's not a lot of movement of phloem in the tree. One of the things that happens when they take in all the nutrients from the plant or tree is they excrete something called honeydew. It's really sugar water, and they probably excrete more of that, almost more of that than they take in. I mean, it's a huge amount of stuff that comes out, and that comes out of the backside and lands and becomes what's called sooty mold, and we'll talk about that in just a second. So some characteristics of the spotted lanternfly. Well, they're hoppers. They're not flyers. They generally fly only a short distance. And one of the studies that recently was done was they were found to fly an average of 23 meters, longest flight being 75. And it depends on the height of the tree and the wind currents of the time. And anecdotally, they've been seen to catch up drafts and fly probably several miles. They almost always seem to be ascending. There's been another study about their movement and releasing them at night and following them around. Pretty cool study. But the conclusion is they're always going up. They're always moving upwards. They want to get to a higher place. They want to get to a higher place either to feed or to launch themselves to a more preferred host where they can get a better meal. When you're dealing particularly with adults, you'll find if you try to catch one that's on a tree, like the ones on the picture here, some may jump off and they'll land. And with each jump, they seem to lose energy. So if you're trying to kill one after a couple of jumps, it will not be jumping very far and be pretty easy to get. They cluster together. They seem to be very social animals, I guess. I don't know. And they cluster often around the joints of trees, as they are doing on this maple here. And they feed most in the afternoons and evenings, less so in the morning and at night. So let's move on here. And I think I jumped a slide. If you turn your volume up, you should be able to hear the sound of these spotted lanternfly on a grapevine. And you can see the honeydew excreted. I think in just a second you'll see it out of this one right here. And there you see it right there, right on the stem. That's honeydew coming out. And when there are many spotted lanternfly in a tree, it almost feels like, it sounds and feels like rain underneath, only it's not rain, it's this sticky, watery substance, sugar watery substance that is coming down as you see it coming down right here. And it's pretty unpleasant. It gets on everything and it turns into something called sooty mold. And I think that's, and this is sooty mold on the leaf of a, I think it's on the leaf of a grapevine. There's more pictures of it. And what happens then is that when the sooty mold lands on vegetation underneath wherever the spotted lanternfly are, what it does is it decreases the photosynthesis that is occurring in that particular plant and obviously damages the plant. So it's not so much the impact of the spotted lanternfly itself sucking phloem out of the plant as much as the photosynthesis loss from the sooty mold that occurs with the excretion of the honeydew. So here's an example of sooty mold on someone's back steps or steps to a deck, I'm not sure which. And you can see it pretty well coats it. I'm sure it's sticky when it first lands, and then it sort of hardens and becomes pretty slippery when it's wet. It's been power washed here on the bottom step. You can still see it sort of etched into the step there. But if you had that spotted lanternfly over your deck or your porch or your terrace or your front walk or over your where you park your car, it's a pretty unpleasant, nasty place to be. And so it's not something that you want. And these are not guests you want in your backyard. So where does it prefer to be? Well, Currently, the list is over 70 species of trees, shrubs, and herbaceous plants, and that list is constantly evolving. There's not many reported on conifers or black cherries or Bradford pears. And generally, when I talk to people, there's agreement on sort of the top 10 plants and trees, and after that, we have little data at present. So the ones that are listed here, tree of heaven, grapevines, black walnuts, silver red maples, river birches, willows, sumacs, and some others. Those are the preferred hosts, and then it varies. Because you'll find a lot of spotted lanternfly on a tree, but they're only there temporarily as they move upwards to then launch themselves to find a better location. And they can be very, very targeted. And I've got the sort of a great example of that on my acre property. I've got 17 different species of trees, and the adults arrived last October, and they fed on only one tree, Astyrix japonica, which is a Japanese snowbell, and they fed on it for 2 weeks in October. It is a preferred tree, and no other trees were targeted. And on that property this year, they've so far been on viburnum, crepe myrtle, cannas, clematis, hydrangea, and passionflower, but have done no damage to those in any significant way. They've all sort of disappeared today, and right now I haven't seen many of the adults. So based on our current understanding, what the spotted lanternfly is a plant stressor. So it doesn't actually kill the plants, most plants that it attacks, although that's not true for tree of heaven or for grapevines. It can decimate a vineyard. But for most of our plant life, it only injures it. And so what that means is that the plant becomes susceptible to something else to kill it. So it becomes susceptible to, it weakens the tree and makes it more susceptible to other diseases such as verticillium wilt or borers or ambrosia beetle or something else that can cause reduced growth, dieback, or eventual death. So it's not necessarily the spotted lanternfly that's the culprit here. So what can you do? Well, first and foremost, we want to prevent the spread. That's the most important thing, because the spotted lanternfly are plant hoppers, meaning they do not really fly. They float kind of, they drift, they sort of coast, but they're not great flyers. Their primary mode of transportation for any distance is car, truck, train, or anything that moves. And they're great hitchhikers and will jump into or onto your car. So you want to use very much common sense when where you're parking and what you ought to do. If there are thousands of them around you when you just park in a parking lot, and you ought to be really careful when you leave, what you take with you. So keep your windows closed. So the second thing we want to do is remove the tree of heaven. So if you have the tree of heaven, which is Ailanthus altissima, and I'll talk a minute about that, we want to get rid of them because they are the preferred host, and we're not entirely sure what role they play, but we know they play a role in the development. I want to destroy egg masses, that's through the winter and spring. I want to kill any nymphs and adults, and I want to emphasize the word responsibly. We don't want to be spraying all kinds of crazy stuff around the air. And finally, we want to educate your neighbors. Very important that everybody understands this. So preventing the spread. Watch where you park. It's very important that you don't pick them up and take them somewhere else. You want to check under and around your vehicle. And you want to make sure you don't leave them opportunities to hop into your car or leave your trunks open so they hop into there. So it's very important that you do that. And that you check your clothing. You know, because they can hop on you, and which they do, and they will come right along with you wherever you're going. So particularly if you're going outside the quarantine zone or outside of Delaware County, make sure you're not taking him with you. So we have a short little clip here that sort of describes, I think, that what that really means. So turn your volume up and you can hear this.
If you are in an area where quarantine is try to take care not to park in the trailer and keep your vehicle closed at all times, windows and doors. If you are hauling anything, take care to drop off your vehicle and inspect it before you open up the car. Check the top, side, bottom, window wheel, remaining along the vehicle if you have an issue with your vehicle. You won't be able to then have a problem. Check on if you have a problem.
So the point here is that you really need to make an extra effort to ensure that you're not carrying spotted lanternfly from a non-quarantined area, which we are in, to a quarantined area, to someplace that doesn't have them. So now let's talk about Tree of Heaven and removing Tree of Heaven. So Tree of Heaven is a, I'd call it a trash tree myself. It's hard to eradicate. It's one of these things where it has this desire to survive, so that if you cut down one, like 10 will pop up all around where you just cut down the one. It's resilient, I think is a good word. It's a very fast growing tree. It tolerates all kinds of conditions, poor soil, pollution, high winds. It's the subject of a tree grows in Brooklyn. It grows in vacant lots along train lines, on parking lots. It grows where nothing else will and grows quickly and sort of takes over. It's again found on the edges of woodlands. It's along the highways in many cases. Very invasive, grows anywhere and everywhere. So how do we recognize it? First off, it has compound leaves like you see below there. That's really one leaf with 10 to 40 leaflets that are opposite each other along the way. So that's the first identifying criteria. And then if you look at the leaves themselves, they're smooth on the edges. They're not ruffled as some are, like a sumac. And they have this notch at the bottom. So you can always tell them from that notch. And also, if you sort of break a twig, if you break one of the twigs to expose the center, it's the pith, it's very spongy in texture, brown in color. It also has a very unpleasant odor as the crushed leaves. They tell me it smells sort of like rotten peanut butter. But that's really how you identify it. So people ask, well, what's the government doing about spotted lanternfly? Well, the government is doing a couple of things, one of which is funding research, a lot of research. And communications, such as we're doing here, they, you know, they fund a lot of communication support around the country for spotted lanternfly. And the attack they've taken for control is largely around getting rid of the tree of heaven. And so there are large efforts to do that. And how they're doing that primarily is using the spotted lanternfly as what's called a trap tree. So there'll be an orchard of ailanthus trees they'll find. They'll cut down all but a couple. They'll cut down all the female trees and leave a couple of the male trees. Then they will infuse those with a systemic insecticide. And what that means is that goes up inside the tree so that when the insects feed on the tree, this is what you get. You get a lot of dead insects because they have taken in the poison as they are feeding. So that's a lot of the effort for controlling right now. We can't go and spray for this insect because we don't have something to spray with for. We don't really know what the right thing to do is. So if you have a tree of heaven on your property or nearby, how do you get rid of it? Well, the first thing you need to do is determine if you have it, and you got to identify it, as I've described. And there's a pamphlet all about that, and I'll give you a link to that at the end of this presentation. So you want to determine, one, if you have it, and two, identify which trees you wish to remove. You may have a spotted or an ailanthus tree that's performing a very important function. I know a guy who's got one that's holding in a bank. It's on a bank, and it's an old tree, and it's holding in the bank, and he's not going to get rid of that tree. So he may want to treat that with an insecticide. So if you want to get rid of them, you want to hack into the trunk of the tree using what's called a hack and squirt method. And you see a picture of someone who's doing that here on the right. You hack into the bark, and then you squirt a concentrate of broad spectrum herbicide, triclopyr or glyphosate. That would be glyphosate is Roundup. Can't remember what the triclopyr generic or commercial name is, but triclopyr is the preferred one at this point. And then you have to remove the dead tree. So once it has died, you have to remove it. So you have to remember that removal of tree of heaven has to include an herbicide. If you don't use the herbicide, you'll just foster more tree of heaven. So then we move on to the third strategy, which is eliminating spotted lanternfly egg masses. Well, we're pretty much past that for this particular season, but if you see any, you want to get rid of them. And they are laid on any surface. I mean, you find those everywhere. They're laid in the fall, overwinter through the winter, and we are not cold enough to, it would have to be down below, I think, 10 degrees for 3 weeks long, 3 weeks in a row for them to actually die. So we're not going to get there. So generally the eggs, and you see the picture on your left there, there are strings of eggs. Those are, there are what, two, there are about seven of them sitting up above it. There, the other strings are underneath that covering. And the covering, we think, is to protect them, but even if they're not protected, we think they still live in most cases. They're roughly 35 to 40 eggs in each egg mass. An adult can lay several different egg masses. And so the extent to which we can get rid of egg masses lowers the number of spotted lanternfly that hatch in the spring. So getting rid of egg masses is a pretty important. And as you see, they land on just about anything, whether it's soft furniture, padding for deck furniture, or a light bulb, or a tire, or wood, or trunks of trees. They're everywhere. So then they hatch, and what do? Well, we need to stop them, and one of the ways to do that is using the sticky tape, the banding with tape around a tree. And there's all kinds of instructions around how to do that. with roughly a 6-inch piece of tape to do that. But the thing that we are finding that we really have to be careful about, and we're really very concerned about, is the what's called bycatch, is catching insects, the good insects, and birds and animals on these traps. And so we need to make sure we use a covering, and that's using netting, as we see here, to do that. And so please don't put up a trap like this unless you're going to use the netting. Another trap is the circle traps. They're finding these are more, these are better. There are descriptions of how to do that on our Penn State website. I'm going to end up with a description of that website at the end, a link to that. But the circle traps are the best way to do that. There are directions for step-by-step direction for how to do that with pictures, and you end up with something like this. So there are the insects go up the tree, into the netting, into a funnel, and then end up in that plastic baggie up there, a Ziploc bag, which you can then empty on some regular basis and continue to catch them. These are quite effective for catching insects, spotted lanternflies, when they are the instars. Well, homeowners, what do you do as a homeowner? Well, if you only have a few, I mean, fly swatters and brooms are just fine, particularly for the adults. They don't work so well for the nymphs. The nymphs are kind of clever, harder to catch. But the adults, brooms and fly swatters, work pretty well if you only have a few. If you have them up in a tree, knocking them down with a long pole or a hose or a power washer, gotta be careful not too hard. And then tracking them down and stomping them works pretty well. Stomping on them wherever you see them is always useful. You can actually use a large mouth plastic bottle and hold the mouth of the bottle, as you see in the picture here below, right over top of them, and they will jump into the bottle. So if you have them on a particular tree, you can go around that tree with the bottle. They will jump into the tree, and each time you catch one, shake it a couple of times, we'll sort of knock them out, and then you'll have a bottle full of dead spotted lanternfly. And that's fine if you only have a few on a tree. If you have a lot on a tree and you want to, you're not dealing with them chemically, then the best way to do that is with a shop vac, some sort of a vacuum cleaner, preferably a shop vac. I used a pond vac because I have a little pond and I had one. It has a longer wand and a longer hose, so it made it easier. And essentially what you're doing is just sucking them off the tree. I first thought you had to create some sort of a net to catch them in, but you can just suck them right into the canister. They don't try to get out. They don't try to crawl out or jump out. They just, I think the pressure of throwing them into that container knocks them out. And within a short period of time, they'll all die, and you can just dump them into a trash, plastic bag. And if you're certainly still feeling like it, you can step on them. That may make you feel a little better to make sure they're dead, but then throw the bag away. So that works pretty well for getting rid of spotted lanternfly that's on a tree that you can reach. When they get too high up, doesn't work so well. Here's an example of, and this one's pretty loud, you may want to turn your volume down. This is a vacuum cleaner, and you can see them all on the tree there, and you can see how this works. So you can clean a lot of spotted lanternfly using a vacuum cleaner. Well, we would like to use other predators to attack the spotted lanternfly, and there are some that do that. There are praying mantises, there are ants. Somebody sent me pictures, I've gotten several pictures recently of spotted lanternfly being captured in a spider's web, but that's really not a practical solution. And please don't go in buy praying mantis eggs to release in your yard, because you'll probably do far more damage to the rest of your insects in your yard than to the spotted lanternfly. The problem with all of these is if you had more of them, you couldn't train them. It's like getting ladybugs, buying ladybugs. You have to train the ladybugs to stay on the plant you want, and that's a pretty difficult thing to do. So while there are other predators, not what we can rely on to get rid of the spotted lanternfly today. So then the question is, well, we've done everything else. We've sucked them off the trees, and yet we still have some trees that they live in that we want to stop that, because it's a nuisance. I want to spend the afternoon in my hammock, and yet they're all in the trees above the hammock. So what do I do? Well, the first thing you want to do is you want to say, well, do you have a lot of them or just a few? And if you only have a few, they're not going to do a whole lot of damage to the tree. They probably are only just on it temporarily before they find something new. And so you just sort of have to live with that. Certainly you can get rid of them to the extent you can. Are the trees that you were concerned about on the preferred host list? And that's a real concern. And do you see any damage to those plants or trees? And do you have bees or other insects that might be harmed by using the insecticides? These are all sort of concerns that you have. Remember, if you're going to use an insecticide, CIDE, that insecticide, herbicide, pesticide, is formulated to kill living things. Well, there's a place for them, but only with a full awareness of the risks and full protection against harm to people, wildlife, and the environment. Look past the labels like natural and organic and focus on toxicity. The world's deadliest poisons like ricin are natural and organic. So you need to think about that when you're going to use them. So what's the potential exposure to kids or pets or wildlife in your yard? So with that, I guess the other question is, can you even reach the spotted lanternfly you have? Are they so far high up in the tree that you're using a shop vac, but you can't reach all the ones that are way up in the tree? We move to something called integrated pest management as a way to think about that. And if you think about the things you want to start with are cultural things. It sort of works from the bottom up. The better things and the least toxic are at the bottom. The most toxic are at the top. You want to promote your plant health. So you want to eliminate the favorite host plant. So if you have tree of heaven, you want to get rid of it. So the more you can limit the stuff that spotted lanternfly wants, the better off you're going to be. Then you're going to destroy egg masses and use traps, which we've talked about. You would like to rely on predators and parasitoids, but you can't. We as individuals really can't do much of that. So then you're left with using either conventional things like contact and systemic insecticides, or the what are called the biorational, the soaps, the oils, the neems, and the pyrethrins. Pyrethrins are made from chrysanthemums, so all of those are more natural chemical products. What we don't want you to use is these home remedies, Dawn liquid, Windex, or bug spray, or vinegar. Those are things that, if you're spraying those, they're just, first off, they're unsafe for human and pets. They're toxic to beneficial insects. They may harm the plants that you're trying to save. They're often flammable, and many of them are illegal. And if you think of trying to spray, let's say even neem oil, which is a good solution, on the nymphs, they don't die right away. And I think what happens is we want to spray it and see it immediately drop dead. Well, neem oil and many of these oils suffocate them, and that takes some time. So you may spray it and they may not die instantly. So you're going to spray it again and again and again and again. And pretty soon you have this chemical all over the place. And that's similar with Dawn liquid or vinegar. I hear a lot of these things where people are using gasoline or torches. It's like amazing the kinds of stuff people will do. Don't do that. It's just not the way to solve this problem. And so beneficial insects, why do we care? So because the part of the concern here is we don't want you using things that are going to harm the beneficial insects. If you're any kind of a gardener, you will have heard of many of the pests that are in the right-hand side. They're aphids, leafhoppers, mites, thrips, mealybugs, scale, spider mites. All of those are plant insects that harm your plants. Well, the bugs on the left are the good bugs. They're the ones who come along and eat the ones on the right. And so if we kill the ones on the if we use a chemical that kills the one on the right but also kills the one on the left, we've suddenly defeated our purpose. And often if you leave things alone, the ones on the left will take care of the ones on the right. So we don't want to get rid of those, nor do we want to get rid of the pollinators. And I would hope everyone understands why we wouldn't want to get rid of pollinators. So let's talk about using insecticides. Well, there are contact insecticides. That's something you spray on the insect like an ant spray, and it kills on contact, so wherever it touches. There's systemics, which you either do into the ground, you inject the tree, or you spray the leaves, and that is absorbed into the plant and kills the insect when it feeds. It's much more complicated to administer, but offers much longer control. So here are the approaches to application. So there's, and along the bottom is the duration of residual effect. That is, how long does it last in the tree? And then how long does it take to get absorbed by the tree so that it works? Well, foliar application gets absorbed pretty quickly, but it doesn't last very long. Bark spray, a little longer, taken up quickly. Trunk injections, even longer. And soil drench is even better. So if you want to use a systemic insecticide, a soil drench can last you up to a year. Some of the soil drenches, there's remnants of the chemical in the ground 5 years later. So that has great long-lasting effects, but it also will kill everything else in the soil, which is not a good thing. So we talked earlier of the, this is the Starix japonica. You wouldn't want to spray this tree before it blooms, but it blooms over the weekend Memorial Day weekend. It blooms for about 3 or 4 days, then it stops. So anytime after that, you can spray it or you can inject insecticides. It is a preferred tree. And so you want to look at sort of things you have to think about is what's the size of the tree, because all of the systemics, you have to measure your dose according to the size of the tree. The bloom time, when to apply it, after it blooms for sure, the strength of the solution applied, and then finally water availability. Because if you don't have enough water to take up into the tree, it's not going to get into the system. And then finally, what's it going to cost? Because some of them are far more costly than others. We recommend that you hire an arborist to help you figure this out, because you don't need to go to every tree. You don't need to... You don't want to treat every tree in your yard, only the ones that are susceptible and the ones that are going to cause the problem. Those are the ones that are high volume trees. So make sure you check the qualifications. And this really, this next bullet, the walk around the property and make sure you're selecting trees that are the primary feeding targets and trees that, if they're heavily infected, could significantly infect your lifestyle. And for the others, you just sometimes have to live with. And look for alternative ways and minimal treatment, because you want to use as little of the chemical applications as possible. Well, we are searching for parasitoids. And now, parasitoids are small wasps that are, we think, control it in China. There are two that are, we think, are the major controls in China. We've brought them back to the United States and have replicated them in a lab in Massachusetts. in a very secure quarantine facility. Research takes anywhere from, I think, 8 to 10 years to do. It's been ongoing now for about three or four. We think this is what has controlled it in the introduction of these parasitoids in Korea, both naturally and intentionally. And we think this is what's controlling the pest in Korea. And so we're looking into that. Another is there are two fungal pathogens found in the United States, found in Pennsylvania, that one is Bovaria bassiana. It's actually currently available, commercially available as insecticide. The other is Bactoa major. And there are studies right now going on with that. There's a study called the Blue Marsh Lake Study where we are looking at finding a landscape scale solutions to spotted lanternfly spread. You're asking what does the government do? This is one of the studies. They're using the soil-borne fungi that's currently available and registered as a biocontrol agent, and they're comparing that to broad-scale application of a standard chemical insecticide called dantrofurin, which is probably the leading standard for systemic for getting to spotted lanternfly. And it's a limited study with 6 acres in a 6,200-acre forest. And this whole study started very controlled, very well thought out. You can read all about it on our website. And this study is, I'm told, is so far not looking great. And that's unfortunate. But it's not over yet. So, message for the day. One, stop the spread. Inspect your car. Close your car windows. Kill anything, egg masses, spotted lanternfly, nymphs, adults you can find, and spread the word. Those are the things you have to remember. And I think not get too bent out of shape and too alarmed with what's happening. Yeah, you want to treat the trees that are going to be difficult for you. So let's talk about the Penn State website where you can get some information real quickly. This is the site. If you just type in PSU spotted lanternfly, it will take you to this website. You click on the manage there on the right-hand side, that box, it will take you to this. And you can't see this, but it lists all kinds of resources, videos, talks, papers, all kinds of stuff that gives you everything that I've talked about here, plus a lot. And there are all these fact sheets. You have a fact sheet on the Tree of Heaven, one on choosing a management care company, one on spotted lanternfly pesticide safety, and then using traps. And then probably the best one, the one you want to start with, is the one in the middle there, Spotted Lanternfly Management for Homeowners. It's a really a great little publication, but all of this information is available. PSU Spotted Lanternfly will take you right to this site, and you got a wealth of information. And so with that, I think we've done our hour. And let's take questions. Just I think Leanne is going to give me those questions they come in.
Thanks so much, Sam. And thank you, everybody, for joining us here tonight. So we've gotten a bunch of questions, so I'm going to go through these one by one. But if you have been listening and you've got a question, go ahead and email your question to repkruger@pahouse.net. That's R-E-P-K-R-U-E-G-E-R at pahouse.net. Or if you want to give us a call, you can reach us at 610-534-6880. So Sam, first question from Kenneth. Is there any danger to my cats who seem to be loving these spotted lanternflies? If our pet cats or any other animals catch a spotted lanternfly and eat it, is there any danger to our pets?
I don't know. I think I have heard stories of some cats not doing well or some animals not doing well with eating them, but I don't think I don't think you have to worry about death or destruction here. I think it's more discomfort than anything else.
Okay.
But I've seen no research on implications of eating spotted lanternfly by pets. Nobody has focused on that topic yet.
Or I guess by kids for that matter either, right?
Or by kids, yes, yes. I mean, I'm sure you could eat one or two. It probably wouldn't kill you. Probably not a terribly pleasant experience and probably teach you not to do it again.
Next question, Sam, from Diane. Can you talk about the negative impact on our tourism industry?
Well, sure. I mean, I think if you go to a park and you want to have a picnic and the picnic area is in a grove of black walnuts and there are spotted lanternfly on them, you're just not going to want to spend a whole lot of time there. And I think you've seen it on the paths you've been hiking, I am sure. They're just everywhere. And it's I guess it's an aesthetic thing. It's creepy. I mean, to see a tree trunk that looks like it's the trunk itself is alive because there's so many bugs packed on it moving. That's pretty unpleasant. Mm-hmm. So I think while there's some damage to trees, I think as much as anything else, it's a feeling that you lose of purity of nature kind of a thing that is really the impact here. I think they certainly do damage, but it's unpleasant to be around. And if you have a high volume and they're dropping mildew or dropping honeydew all over you, you certainly don't want to be there. And I think that's really the intangible sort of effect to our parklands and to recreational facilities.
Next question from Shannon. Can you go over those expansion numbers again and explain exactly what they mean?
Oh, okay.
I think you had an early slide that had that chart with the expansion numbers.
Sure. And anybody can do this. If you multiply any number, start with the number. Let's say you start out with 50 spotted lanternfly and take that times 17. The result of that is let's say you started with 100 and you take it times 17, you get 1,700. Well, then the next year you have 1,700, so you take that by 17. So each year you are multiplying by 17 each year. And what that chart showed you is that within a very, very short time, you get to billions. I mean, literally billions. And actually, soon after that, literally a year or two later, you get to trillions. I mean, the numbers mount up very, very quickly when you have a reproduction rate of 17. And really what 17 means, if you think of, let's say half the population of spotted lanternfly is female. And I think it's roughly half. I don't exactly know what the number is. But let's say it's half. And so half the population lays two egg masses. Well, that's, you know, and half that, and then the average is 34. So you get to that 17 number pretty quickly, pretty easily, actually. So the point of the expansion is that they are multiplying so rapidly that we need solutions that are beyond the scale of just banding trees. Mm-hmm. All right, the banding trees help you on your property. Banding trees will limit a particular location, but in terms of ultimate impact on the population of spotted lanternfly region-wide or nationally, it's literally a drop in the bucket. Mm-hmm. So from a scale point of view, we're not dealing with it in any effective way.
So we've got a bunch more questions here, which is great. Thank you so much, folks, for following along and sending your questions in. We've got a question from John. How often should I be reporting sightings? I've had days of seeing 25 and only being able to kill 5 of them, and other days when I've seen 18 and killed 16. Is it important that I'm reporting this information?
We talked about this at our last call, and here's what happens is when you, the real issue with reporting is that the state and states, I will say plural, want to know where is it moving? And is it going someplace where it isn't already? So is it going to a county where it is not already established? So that's a primary concern. They are capturing the data from whatever we send in and recording it. So if you say, I mean, if you're using the website and you identify, you know, 10 spotted lanternfly on a sycamore tree, then they will record that in whatever town you live in, whatever your zip code is. So that's a good thing, but nobody's doing anything with that data. It would be really good if we had some, you know, bright-eyed graduate student who would take up a project for taking all that data and then telling us, you know, well, what's the incidence by tree type, by tree species of the spotted lanternfly, but they're currently doing nothing with that data, although they are capturing it and the data is available. So while it's nice to do, it's of less importance to continue to report it if you are already in a quarantine area.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next question, is there something that can be done about spotted lantern flies on larger properties or public properties, such as that owned by SEPTA?
Well, there are a couple of questions in there because public properties, they're trying, is where the focus is for killing Tree of Heaven. And particularly along railroad lines and highways, railroad lines specifically. And they're looking for ways to develop some insecticide or herbicide, which they can use to kill Tree of Heaven, either through some aerial spray or something like that, along those pathways, mm-hmm. and thus get rid of spotted lanternfly. But that's the only thing they're talking about right now.
Okay. And I know that the county has gotten a small grant from the Department of Agriculture on this. They're using it predominantly in Rose Tree Park in Media and at George Hill at the prison to try to cut down on spotted lanternfly. So, you know, hopefully that's something that could be expanded in the future if the Department of Agriculture has more funding.
Right. And those are where all that money is going again. It's elimination of Tree of Heaven.
Okay. So it's eliminating the plant source first to then try to eliminate the
plant. We don't have any good way of getting rid of the insect. It's not like there's some chemical we can, you know, or ride around with airplanes spraying whole neighborhoods without doing far more damage to you and me than we would really want done.
Got it. So we've got another question here from Charlotte. Do you think it's possible that spotted lanternfly may spread north as winters grow warmer? I understand that the spotted lanternflies cannot really migrate on its own, but might it survive in a broader range if it's moved accidentally?
Oh, it does. Yes. Two questions there. I mean, certainly it can go south quite easily. We would be concerned if it went south. It had two cycles a year, which is possible because its life cycle is a function of degree days. Degree days are a function of heat over time. So if you have a lot of hot days in a short period of time, you have more degree days. So hotter weather longer, things happen more quickly with the spotted lanternfly. It moves through its stages more quickly. It gets to where it can mate and can generate eggs. So there are even areas in Pennsylvania, northern Pennsylvania, where there are not enough degree days for it to get to the mating cycle. So we're not worried about spotted lanternfly in the coldest areas of of Pennsylvania, not because the eggs don't live through the winter, but because there's not enough time for it to get to a mating season. Okay? So moving north is less of an issue than it moving south or west.
Got it. And it looks like our last question that we've received is from Henry. What's the recommended way to destroy or dispose of egg masses that we could find this winter?
Crush them. This business of scraping them into a bag, I don't know how anybody's going to do that. If you see them on a tree, if you take a little roller that you know, like those rollers you use for wallpaper seams, if you take those and roll those over an egg mass, crushes
like a paint
them.
Roller?
Yeah. Well, no, something. It's like a little hard roller. It's maybe. Mm-hmm.
Like the inside of the paint roller before you put the puffy part on it?
There you go.
The hard plastic part?
Yeah. If you have something that's a roller, particularly if you have it on a long pole or something, you can get to an awful lot of them. And if you roll back and forth over it, it will pop them and kill them. But
it looks like
squishing them is the best way to do it.
Squishing them. And that sounds, you know, I've got an 8-year-old son. That sounds like a great job for a kid.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
it looks like we just got a question in voicemail, which you may have covered already, but let me just read this again. This is Rick calling in from Brookhaven. I bought a systemic solution to try to save my maple trees. Is this a good time to use it, or is it too late? What's the best time to use a systemic solution?
There are lots to unpack with that, because it depends on the solution and it depends on the application method. So, and it depends on when they're going to when the spotted lanternflies show up. So if you're using a soil drench, which could last you for a year, and you're going to use that on your maple tree, if the spotted lanternfly haven't showed up yet and they're not going to show up for another month, you'll be fine. But it takes a month for that systemic to get up into the system. If you do a bark spray, it gets in much more quickly. It doesn't last as long, though. It may only last 10 weeks. 10 weeks may get you through the season, though.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm working on my Japanese snowbell tree, that last year they didn't arrive till October, I got plenty of time. And they were only here for 2 weeks. So if they're only going to be here for 2 weeks, I could even do a foliar spray in 2 weeks. You know, like in early, or mid-October, and be fine.
Mm-hmm.
So it really depends on, one, what's the chemical and what's the duration? Two, what's the application method? Three, what tree and when are they going to be there? So it's not a simple solution. And that's why we recommend that you use an arborist who can answer all of those questions for you, because you don't want to be using something that won't do you any good. Because using some of them is really unproductive, because they're going to be on some trees only temporarily. And mm-hmm. And you're just wasting money and effort. You don't want to treat all of the trees on your property. You know, it's there are a few people who will treat many trees on their property. Probably only a few, if any. And then it depends on the tree, the time you have, and when they may arrive.
Got it. Well, Sam, I so wish we had held this presentation earlier, because I told you I was starting to see the nymphs on my cucumbers. I went to a community message board to see what to do. I tried vinegar, and all it did was turn my leaves brown, but it still didn't get the spotted lanternfly nymph. So I'm grateful for your time today. I'm seeing adults around my property right now, so I keep a long yardstick to the back door because I see them on my back porch. And sometimes I'm in the middle of a conference call and put it on mute real quick, and I'm smacking the spotted lantern flies. That's working much better than the vinegar did.
There you go. Good for you.
Well, thank you so much for your time tonight. We're really grateful for sharing this presentation with us. Can you give us that website one more time if folks have any last questions that they want to go look up?
You want to type in PSU for Penn State University, spotted lanternfly. That's all you got to do. It's PSU spotted lanternfly, and that will take you to the Penn State Spotted Lanternfly website, which will be just have tons of information, more information than you will ever get through.
Wonderful. Well, thank you again. This is Sam Barnett from Penn State Cooperative Extension, one of our leading voices on spotted lanternfly. I'm State Representative Leanne Krueger, hosting this workshop from my home here in Delaware County. Thanks so much for joining us tonight. And if you've got any follow-up questions, please go to that website. There's so much information there. I clicked on it myself a little while ago. You can get lost in the resources.
Or call your local master gardener.
Or call your local master gardener. And remind us again, how do we find those folks?
Well, again, go to the PSU Master Gardener website and take it to Delaware County, and you'll find our hotline there.
Wonderful. Well, thanks again for your time tonight. Thank you, everybody, again, for joining us. This is the end of our presentation. Okay, thanks so much, folks.
Through the winter, but because there's nothing depends on the tree.
This is the end of our presentation.